Ladies and gentlemen, we welcome you to the Provo Municipal Council meeting. Today is Tuesday, January 20th. It's 5:30 p.m. and we're convened in the City Center Conference Room. We're glad and grateful that you've joined us here today. We'll begin the meeting with a roll call. And Mayor, could we start with you?
Al Miller.
Gary Winterton.
Gary Garrett.
Kim Santiago.
Dave Sewell.
Dave Van Buren.
Brian Jones.
Matt Taylor.
Thank you. And Councilmember Stephen Hales is excused. This meeting is being broadcast live on Provo City Channel 17 and channel 17.provo.org, where it will also be available for on-demand viewing. The council requests that citizens help maintain the decorum of this meeting by turning off electronic devices and by being respectful of presenters and council members and others by refraining from applause during the proceedings of the meeting. We'll begin with an opening prayer and pledge that will be led by Ben Drews, who's a member of the Boy Scout Troop 778 here in Provo. Ben, if you'd like to come forward, we'll start with a prayer and then have you lead us in the pledge.
Our kind Father in heaven, we thank thee for this day and we thank thee for all of our many blessings. We're especially thankful at this time for our ability to all gather here, and we're especially thankful for this land and all the freedoms that come with it. And please bless that those who are in attendance today can have clear minds and that you can have your will be felt. And we say these things in the name of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. And if you'll please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Ben. We'll begin with a series of presentations and proclamations that we have this evening. First, a special presentation that we'd like to make by way of a tribute to Representative Becky Lockhart, who, as you know, passed away last week. We are honored to have Stan Lockhart with us here today and friends and family members, and know it's been a challenging and busy time for you, Stan, and are honored that you would take time to be with us here today to hear this tribute that we'd like to place for Becky. And I, as you know, Stan served on the city council here for a term a few years ago. So I'll turn the time over to Councilmember Kim Santiago to make the presentation.
Rebecca Dawn Lockhart, known to us as Becky, passed away at her Provo, Utah home on January 17, 2015. Born on November 20, 1968, in Reno, Nevada, she received a Bachelor of Sciences degree in nursing from Brigham Young University, practicing for 7 years as a registered nurse. Becky and her husband, Stan, raised their children, Hannah, Emily, and Stephen, in Provo, and often expressed great love for the city. Stan is familiar to us as a former member of the Provo City Council, including serving as council chair. His service to Provo also includes time on the Planning Commission, Board of Adjustment, and the Provo Library Board. Together, the Lockharts have given much of themselves to the city of Provo. Becky Lockhart was a member of the Utah House of Representatives, representing the state's 64th district, which covers central and southeast Provo, as well as North Springville. She was first elected to office in 1998 and served as Assistant Majority Whip in 2008. On November 4th, 2010, she was chosen by her colleagues to be Speaker of the House, the first woman in Utah history to hold the top leadership position. Her service in the House ended just last month. She was a tireless advocate for issues of concern to residents of Provo. As Representative Mia Love stated, quote, "Becky Lockhart helped many of us find our voice to preserve life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness," end quote. She worked hard on a number of issues important to cities in Utah, including transportation funding, including the I-15 core project, retirement systems reforms, health care, clean air, and education, where she specifically sought and obtained higher education funding equity that helped UVU meet the needs of Provo students. Jen Gonnelly of the League of Women Voters of Utah said, quote, "She had a great affection for education and fought for the education of all the students in Utah." Recently, she served with Council Members Santiago and Winterton on the Council's Budget Committee, adding her experience perspective to the voices of other community leaders on that committee. She encouraged women in Utah to be involved politically and to run for office, regardless of their party affiliation. Becky affirmed to women that, quote, "Using your real voice might make you uncomfortable. It might make the people around you feel uncomfortable. But until we make it normal for women to be heard, until we are heard for our ideas and not viewed as tokens, that's the price we'll pay. I, for one, have been willing to pay that price," end quote. Governor Herbert echoed the sentiments of many when he said, quote, "While she was first and foremost a wonderful wife and mother, she was also a remarkable role model, particularly to the untold numbers of women who were inspired by her example to be involved in public service. The state of Utah is a better place because of the service and sacrifice of Becky Lockhart," end quote. As wonderful as her contributions and achievements to the state of Utah and Provo City were, those that knew her treasured the contributions she made within her home and to her friends, neighborhood, and church. Becky spent her off time quilting, used as a means to remove her mind from politics. It was ultimately a means to bless others as well. She gave quilts to those in need and to others to say thank you for their service. Becky's dedication to her family leaves a lasting legacy that will continue on through each of them in their own lives and service. Rachel Benson, a Facebook friend, summed it up, quote, "Life is precious. Becky always seemed to be making the most of hers," end quote. We offer our gratitude for Becky Lockhart's years of service, countless contributions to the community, and for inspiring others to speak up and to have a voice. To the Lockhart family, we extend our hearts and our deepest sympathies. We have a copy of this for you as well.
I'm so pleased to have just a moment myself and to have Stan here with me. I'm honored. Stan, you're no stranger in these chambers, and like your wife, have influenced so many good things in our city. Becky's illness and the speed of the illness have left us all at a little bit of a loss and understanding how to absorb this. But I think the one thing that stands out clear is that Becky established a standard for young women, the ability to dream and the ability to achieve great things, and inspired them in so many ways. And I'm pleased to announce that in conjunction with the Lockhart family, Provo City has the intentions to build a memorial here in our city to honor Becky, yes, for the many things she accomplished, but above all else for her inspiring way that she inspired young women. And it will be the intent of the memorial to inspire young women to achieve great things like Becky did in her life. It's early in discussions, and we haven't had a lot of time to work out all the details that will be involved with the memorial, but I'm pleased to announce that it will be taking place. We hope people who would like to reach out and extend their sympathy to the family might consider donating to the memorial, and that can be done by donating to the Provo Foundation through the Provo City, and we look forward with the family to announcing that details into the future. And with that, I would like to invite Stan, if you wouldn't take just a minute to share your thoughts as well with us.
Well, I don't know how many of you knew Becky, but she's really cool. When she became Speaker of the House, people wanted to tag her with, "You got elected Speaker because you're a woman." And man, talk about an allergic reaction. She did not want to hear it. She wanted to hear that she was there because she had earned it. And she had. And then almost immediately, people started bringing their daughters to get pictures with her. And as the first woman Speaker of the House, they wanted their daughters to have that experience. And Becky's perspective just started changing a little bit. And over time, over the 4 years that she was Speaker of the House, she became a passionate defender of women, of trying to help women dream big, and then trying to find ways to help them achieve those hopes and dreams. And so, as we move forward to try to do something that honors Becky but that inspires young women, I can tell you that she's looking down from the spirit world right now with a big grin, and she's saying, "Thank you."
Thank you, Stan. And finally, as part of our tribute to Representative Lockhart, please join us in a moment of silence. Thank you. Thank you again, Stan, for being here today. Thank you, Kurt and Susie Bramble, for joining us as well. Appreciate your being here also. Thank you. Stay as long as you'd like. We have a second presentation that is our, in a continuing tradition to become aware of the arts programs here in Provo City and what's being presented here in the Covey Center and available to our citizens by way of arts. We'd like to turn the time over to Lauren Nielsen from the Arts Department, who will give a presentation, who will share with us a presentation related to Tom Holdman Studios and an upcoming exhibition. Lauren, we'll turn the time over to you.
Thank you so much for having us. It's an honor to be here. My name is Lauren Nielsen, and I work at the Covey Center for the Arts. I do a few different things there, but my favorite thing is coordinate the art galleries. And we have a big exhibit coming up in February. It opens up Friday, February 6th. And this is one of the bigger ones that we've had in a while, so we wanted to present to you tonight. We have James Graham from Tom Holdman Studios here tonight to tell us a little bit about their studios, about their blown glass art, and what we can expect to see in this upcoming exhibit. So I'll go ahead and turn the time over to James, and we hope to see you guys all there. Thank you.
Good evening, City Council members. It's an honor, and we're grateful to be able to be with you this evening. Tom himself can be here. He's in Peru, or else he'd fly all the way back out here to talk to y'all today. I'm the gallery director at Holdman Studios, the assistant gallery director, and I've been working there since I was 15, so for 8 years now. I love glass, and that's what Tom is passionate about, is working with glass all around the world. He has glass in many countries throughout the world, in all 50 states. We have counted that there's glass from our studios there. And so we're very excited to work with the Covey Center to be able to bring this to Provo and to the people here, but also extending throughout the Utah region, because it's something that it speaks to all of us. I mean, we use glass in every part of our day with our cell phones, cameras, windows, everywhere, and it's the way we look through life is with glass. And so Tom's taken that to a whole new level by able to imagine different ways of glass. As we look on the first slide up here, these are chandeliers made. They're Trujillo-esque, and we're excited that we're able to feature one of these here at the Covey Art Center. It'll be a transition from blue to clear, and they'll be sitting in the middle of the art gallery. They're beautiful features, and when they're all lit up, it's amazing to walk around them and see how many hundreds of glass pieces go into them to make them each day. Other things include glass platters. At the studio currently, this is being housed and displayed, is this wall of glass platters. We won't be bringing that whole wall down here. That'll take several shipments, but we'll be bringing smaller versions of this to the Covey Center. Also things, this is a closer-up picture of that that will be displayed. Other things can include on the ceiling. We're big fans of platters. We do a unique, larger platters than are ever seen in other studios, and we're very proud of that, that we can do larger scale versions of those things. Other things that may be exhibited are stained glass windows, and we're going to be excited to bring those things. And I brought an example here of a vase, and there's many other things that can be displayed that show the different craftsmanships of blown glass. And we're excited for this event. We're excited to showcase a model of glass that will be there, and we hope that all of you be able to attend that event. Thank you.
Could you remind us when the event will be, when the exhibition will be in place?
February 6th is when it is open to the public.
For how long?
For 2 months.
2 months. So beginning February 6th here in the Covey Center for 2 months. Wonderful. Any questions or comments? Thank you very much, and thank you, Lauren. Thanks for your help in getting this exhibition here to Provo. It will be a wonderful, beautiful addition to our gallery. Thank you. Thank you. Next, our final presentation will be to be presented by Mayor Curtis to the Bicycle Collective here in Provo. Oh, and Aaron, are you introducing?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
So I'd like to thank the council and the mayor for allowing us to present this award. It has a bit of a clunky name. It's the Canyon Bicycles Winter Bike Commuter Golden Spoke Award. appreciate the council's support last year as you approved the Provo Bicycle Master Plan, and we look forward to your support as the city does things this year, such as apply for CBDG funds for the 200 East Neighborhood Greenway project, and as we, as a city, host the Utah Bike Summit in Provo for the first time, and that will be on April 10th at the Provo Library, and we'd like to hope that you will all make time to be there. I'd also like to thank Canyon Cycles just down Center Street for sponsoring this award. For the past 3 years during Bike to Work Week here in Provo, we've had the mayor present a kind of a general Bicycle Commuter Golden Spoke Award. And this year, we decided as a Provo Bicycle Committee to create this Winter Bicycle Commuter Award to highlight that even in the dead of winter, and especially on spring-like days like today, that any day is a good day to bicycle to work and to bicycle to school. In short, every month, every week is a bike month and bike week. And I just, before I have the mayor present the award, I'd like to just count down the 7 not-so-secret benefits of biking through the winter. Number 7, it makes you feel like a rebel to know that the cold can't beat you. Number 6, you never have trouble finding bike parking. Number 5, Friends and peers may think you're nuts, but they're secretly impressed. Number four, it's all about the layers, but it's not as specialized or as complicated as you think. I like the slogan, there's no such thing as bad weather, it's just bad gear. So if you dress warmly like your mother told you to, you should have no problem. Number three, you'll be warmer riding your bike than waiting for your car to heat up. And number two, you won't foul the air and you can easily earn one of the mayor's clean air pins. And number one, some days it's safer to walk or to take transit than to ride, but doing so does not make you any less of a rebel. Mayor Curtis.
Thank you, Aaron. Yes, please. Aaron, come stand up here with, if you would, with me. And before we introduce our award winner, I just need to give Aaron a shout out. It would be hard to find a community activist more effective than Aaron. And many of that comes from his balance of patience and impatience with us. And I want you to know we appreciate especially the patient side of that balance. And you're a great example to us and all that you do in the community. So with that is Lexi. Lexi, come up. Let me shake your hand and introduce you to the council. And Lexi, we're kind of going to do this dysfunctional thing where we're going to talk to both the council and our audience at the same time. And let me tell you just a tad bit about Lexi. I understand that Lexi got hooked in high school on riding her bicycle and rides it. She lives on the west part of our city, which is significant if you understand that she rides it up to BYU for her classes and back 10 miles every day, every day. Rain or shine?
Yeah.
Rain or shine. She also uses her bikes for errands and shopping and recreation on the Provo River Trail. And is just a tremendous example to us of how to improve our life through bicycle riding. And with that, we present our award to you. And Aaron, do you want to tell her a little bit more about what the award is?
It's a gift certificate from Canyon Bicycles. So you can get any bicycle item you desire within the amount on the card, which is $40.
Yeah. All right. Lexi, would you like to speak? Give us a speech? How about just tell them to ride their bikes?
Hi, I've never done anything like this before. In all honesty, I never thought I'd get anything special for just riding my bike to and from my work and school. And I've had a few little hiccups along the way, especially with the Provo River Trail construction. A couple of people decided to move a few signs out of the way, and I got a little stuck, and but it's a good reward, and I'm very grateful for the people that decided to technically throw me under the bus for this. But it's nice to be recognized for something that I didn't think was really any really significant in any way, shape, or form. I just wish that it'd be a little bit more safer for bicyclists to ride their bikes in Provo with the more bicycle lanes, because as we all know and are aware of, people who drive cars in Provo City can be a little crazy.
Thank you, Lexi. A good reminder to all of us in automobiles. And I'm pleased to announce, or really to remind us, that the West Side Connector that's being built from our freeway out towards the airport will have a beautiful trail separated from the road alongside of it. So another avenue for the west side to commute over to the east side. Thank you and congratulations, and thank you, Aaron.
Do you mind if my brother and my adopted brother take
a selfie? No, good. Would you like to invite the council to come be in your selfie?
Yeah, sure.
Are you game, council?
Okay. One, two, three, five. Oh, it, let me try one more time. One, two, three, smile.
Lexi, congratulations. Thank you for coming and your friends as well. We'll get there with bike safety and bike trails with Aaron's help and others, where I think we're making great progress in our city. Before we begin public comment, I would like to ask for a motion to approve the minutes of our last council meeting, January 6th. If everybody's had a chance to review those, someone like to make a motion? Mr. Miller? Thank you, making a motion. And a second by Mr. Van Buren. Thank you. Any comments?
Yeah, I did have a, let me look it up here really quick. On the minutes, we need to record that there was a second on the vice chair vote. I think there was a first, but not a second noted. There wasn't a second. Okay, so Brian?
Brian, is that okay?
Yeah, we're fine.
So it's fine.
We've got built-in provisions that say failure to abide by our standard practices don't invalidate the action, so we're okay.
Okay, thank you. And did we need to record then that Stephen Hales was put in his chair and David Sewell as vice chair? It talked about RDA leadership, but I don't think their names were actually put in. I know that was read into the, probably on the video, but as far as the minutes, I didn't see it in the minutes.
It might not have appeared in the, I'd have to refer to Janine, but there was a written resolution, and when they voted on the resolution, their names were read into the resolution.
They read it into the resolution. So does that need to be recorded in writing in the minutes, or is the video
Just for clarity, so that somebody wouldn't have to go find the resolution, that's probably a better practice, but it's not absolutely necessary, but probably make it easier for somebody to find that information.
Okay. Okay. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Janine, for making that review and change if necessary. Those then who can vote to approve the minutes, please indicate. And that is unanimous. Thank you. We'll now open the meeting for public comment. This is the segment of our meeting where...
Oh, you know, sorry. We just vote. I had another thing on the minutes, too, and this might be significant or maybe not. In the motion for the water conservation needs, the word approve was not put in the minutes. And so that was another thing. Sorry, I thought the water was part of the rest of our business. And then on part four, the last sentence, it said, or any member of council was written twice. I didn't know why, if that was necessary or if that was part of, okay, anyway. So I think that's it. Just the word approve needed to be put in the motion, I believe, right? Brian, is that?
I don't have the minutes in front of me, but yeah, it sounds like that was just an oversight where the word just wasn't included in the minutes. So
that was in the motion for the water conservation needs. It was actually in the motion. The word proof was missing. So, and that's it. Thank you. Sorry about that.
Thank you. Janine, would it be helpful if Councilmember Santiago sends you those edits in an email? Would that be helpful? Sure. Okay. Thank you. At this time, any person in attendance may comment on matters that do not appear on tonight's agenda. Should you wish to make a comment at the podium, please speak into the microphone and state your name and city of residence. Should you not wish to speak, but instead have your statement read by the recorder, please provide her with a copy of your statement. Those who speak should do so courteously and briefly. Be aware that the council and administration are not able to take any formal action on matters that arise during public comment, but we may respond informally as appropriate. Also, be aware that there are additional means for addressing the council and administration, including email, telephone, and social media, all of which are listed on the Provo City website. Thank you. Those with comments are invited to approach the podium.
Diane Christensen, Provo, Provost Neighborhood. I just want to thank the council for making the decision to do the tribute to Becky Lockhart. I'm sure it meant a lot to the family, and it means a lot to those of us who loved and admired Becky. I want you to know that I'm already aware of two donations to the Provo Foundation to be used for her memorial. And I just want to share with you one memory that I have of Becky, and that is that at one time a couple of years ago, I asked Becky to help me with a political matter that could have been damaging to her. It could have hurt her to help me with that. But I knew she stood with me on principle, so I thought I would ask her anyway. And she instantly said yes. Never mind the outcome, never mind counting the cost to herself. She was a woman of principle, someone I try to model myself after in that way. And I feel like my life is better for having known her. And thank you for letting me say that.
Thank you, Diane. If there's no other public comment, we'll continue with the next item on our agenda, which is a public hearing on a resolution authorizing the issuance and sale of water revenue bonds, authorizing the execution and delivery of a master indenture and supplemental indenture, authorizing the taking of all other actions necessary for the consummation of the transactions contemplated by this resolution. This will be presented by our finance director, Dan Follett.
Council Chair Garrett and Honorable Municipal Council, the city sold bonds today in the amount of approximately $12 million, water revenue bonds. That sale is subject to a couple of council actions this evening, the first being a public hearing and the second being approval of the resolution by the council. I will mention that we feel like we were able to take advantage of a very favorable interest rate market that exists right now. We sold the bonds, 20-year bonds at 2.68% is the interest rate on those bonds over the full term. If it's okay with the council, I would ask that Brian Baker, who is our municipal advisor from Zions Bank, come forward and provide you with the details of that sale and how that went. I would also mention that Eric Hunter, who's our bond counsel from Chapman and Cutler, is here. John Borgett, Director of Administrative Services. Dave Decker, who's Director of Public Works. And Bart Simons and Jimmy McKnight from Public Works are also here if you have questions. I'll turn it over to Brian now, if that's okay.
That will be fine. Thank you, Mr. Follett. Welcome, Mr. Baker.
Thank you. I'm grateful to be here this evening. And they say it's better to be lucky than good, but it's better to both be good and lucky than just one or the other. And Provo City, with your bond ratings and with the way that you manage yourselves, has yourself in a great position today. So at 9:15 in the morning, it was open to all bidders, any underwriter across the country who wanted to submit a bid for your water bonds, and then at 9:45 for your wastewater bonds. You received 8 bids, and some of them, if you thought to yourself, who would be interested in buying our bonds? Most of the names on this bidders list would not be people who would jump to your mind at all. So it's just fascinating who is out there in the market and who is hungry and anxious to get their hands on your bonds. So the winning bidder was Jenny Montgomery, which is based in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. And so they provided you the most aggressive bid on both your water and your wastewater bonds. So they won the deal at 9:15 and then said, well, we're coming back in half an hour and we hope to win that one too. And sure enough, they did. And the rates that you got, both based on what's going on in the interest rate market right now, which is tremendously in your favor, and based on the strength of your credit, truly played to your advantage. I think when we met with council before and talked about things, we provided numbers that were significantly higher than 268. And ironically, I looked back because I was scratching my head today and thinking, we sold bonds in 2011 for the rec center, and that was a very successful sale. We were all very excited about how strong the rate was. That rate was 1.5% higher than the rates you saw today. So it was a 4.19% is what we saw in the GO bonds for the rec center. But the purpose of the public hearing is a legal requirement that allows, essentially the legal reason is the public is allowed to comment on whether there are any private competition issues with private business within the city, which generally you wouldn't see on a water and wastewater system. But you should all be very proud of your city for the way you conduct yourselves. When we went and met with the bond rating agencies, the representatives who were there for the city represented you very, very well. It was a pleasure to work with your public works department. I think they do a great job, and I was very impressed with all of them, and just want to congratulate you on a great sale, and happy to answer any questions about the sale and as well the bond, Eric Hunter, our bond attorney, if you have questions about the legal mechanism of the resolution before you.
Thank you, Mr. Baker. Are there any questions for Mr. Baker? Mr. Winterton?
I know that we're going to be looking at a possible bond down the road a couple of years again. Do you see any challenges with the bond that we've got now making it more difficult for us because of the debt that we have now, or are we still in pretty good shape from what you after experiencing today?
I think you're in great shape, and in fact it was fully discussed and disclosed. One thing that they like to see is forward planning and the fact that you aren't just going to show up one day and say, hey, guess what, we need $15 or $20 million more, but that you, the capital facilities plan that the Public Works Department has for both water and wastewater are very comprehensive and go into great detail about the possible future debt issuance, what sort of rate increases may or may not be necessary to get there, what the fund balances for those funds look like over the next 10 years. And so you have a very exhaustive, detailed document that you're able to hand to them and that they look through and comb over and ask questions about. And so I don't anticipate that being a problem. In fact, the issuance of additional water revenue bond debt in a couple of years is taken into account in the rating that they gave you. They basically assume that it's being done.
Thank you. Thank you. If there are no other questions at this time, we'll open the meeting for a public hearing and invite any who would care to speak to this item to approach the podium at this time. Seeing no public comment, we'll ask if there is any additional council discussion or questions or issues that they'd like to address to any of the members who are here representing this item. Ms. Santiago?
This is just a question for clarification, and I don't know if this may be for Public Works, but didn't we talk about $12 million instead of $10 million? And how did that, because that we were going to be able to save money in the long run, and is this, I don't know even how to frame the question, I'm not sure. I tried to look it up this morning to see the in the context of our conversation earlier, but it seemed like we were going to ask for $12 million instead of $10 million, if you could explain
that. Happy to address it. When bidders submit bids on your bonds, they determine both the coupon rate and the interest rate that they want to offer you. And so the coupon rate is what's stated on the bonds. And most investors don't want to own bonds that have coupon rates that are as low as what actually the market would dictate right now. So they don't want to own a bond that says 2% on it or 2.5%. So they put 4% on some of your bonds. And for instance, on your 8-year bond, they put a 4% coupon on it. So instead of giving you dollar for dollar, $1 for every dollar's worth of bonds, they gave you actually $1.25 for every dollar worth of bonds. And so you generated an amount of premium that made it so selling $10.775 million in bonds, which is the par amount for the water bonds, gives you $12 million for public works, pays the underwriter the fee that they charged you, which was incredibly low, by the way, and then pays the other costs of issuance related to the bond transaction. So both of the par amounts give wastewater the $10 million that they were looking for and give water the $12 million they were looking for and then pay the other costs associated with the transaction.
Okay. Thank you for clarifying that.
Any other questions? If not, I'll look for a motion then related to this resolution.
I'd like to make that motion that we adopt this resolution approving the sale of these bonds.
Thank you, Mr. Winterton. And a second? Ms. Santiago, thank you for your second. Those in favor? That voting is unanimous with Mr. Hales excused. We'll turn to the next item now, which is related to the previous item, a public hearing on the resolution authorizing the issuance and sale of wastewater revenue bonds, authorizing the execution and delivery of a master indenture and supplemental indenture, authorizing the taking of all other actions necessary for the consummation of the transactions contemplated by this resolution. Mr. Follett, back to you.
Thank you. So approximately 30 minutes after we sold the water bonds, we sold the wastewater bonds, and the bond proceeds will be approximately $10 million that will be utilized to make improvements in the wastewater system. The same underwriter actually bid on the bonds, and we got almost the identical same rate of 2.68%. on those bonds, which we would expect with identical ratings, et cetera, the wastewater had compared to water, they were the same. So based on that, the council is again being asked to do two things this evening. One is approve a public hearing, and the second is hold a public hearing, and the second is to approve a resolution. And then, if I may, I'll turn it over to Brian for just a minute again and let him give you some of the highlights on the wastewater sale.
Well, again, I would just state that, interestingly enough, of the eight bidders that bid on the water bonds, all eight of them bid again on the wastewater bonds, and most of them hardly changed their bid at all, even though after the first bid, they knew that they lost or won, and they knew what the winning rate was. And so it was kind of ironic. We didn't know how much it would change, whether certain bidders would drop out because they didn't want to be that aggressive, or whether the bidders that were close to the top would have really sharpened their pencils. But it turned out that the winning bidder changed, one tiny thing to become just a little tiny bit more aggressive. One other interesting fact is that we asked them whether they had pre-sold any of these bonds, because they're buying them, and once you see the rates and once you accept the rate, they own the bonds. They're going to take them and they're going to pay you for them. And so they then have to turn around and try to sell them and make money off them. And obviously, if they were the most aggressive bidder, they paid a price for the bonds that the seven other bidders were not willing to pay. They said, that's too expensive for us. We're not going to buy them at rates that low or prices that high. And they actually indicated that they had called around a lot and that they had sold a good majority of your bonds before they were even priced. And so it just shows the strength of the credit and the strength of the market right now, that you have investors clamoring for very, very low rate debt from an entity like yourself.
So again, Mr. Baker, what was the difference between the two, 2.68 on these bonds?
Well, it comes down to a rounding amount. There's probably half a basis point better.
I see.
So the water bonds were something like 2.675, and then the wastewater bonds were like slightly better than that.
I see.
But it's really a rounding error there.
I see.
We decided it was easier to just round them to the same number,
right,
and just say that everybody did just as well.
Okay, thank you. Any questions?
I do have a question. I'm just curious about the process. As the bids come in, the interest rates and all the particulars come in, do other bidders, do they actually get a chance to see what other bidders are doing before the process is closed, or do they submit bids and then the best bid is chosen without necessarily the others participating?
Yep. What happens is there's a fixed date and time where all bids are due by, they can submit a bid, they can retract the bid up until that final timeline. And so at certain points, we'd say, oh, there are three bids in, and then, oh, now there's two, oh, now there's one, and then, oh, they pop back in. They cannot see who else is bidding, and they cannot see what the best bid is at that time. A few years ago, there was another system developed that allowed the people who weren't in the lead to know that they weren't in the lead so that they could sharpen their bids and things like that. And while that may have been a more efficient tool and might have gotten better rates in some instances, it simply didn't catch on. If, you know, we had eight bids here, and under a system like that, you would have only had a couple of bidders because it was a system that didn't catch the market's interest. You know, also Bloomberg started a system 15 years ago that we helped them develop, and that didn't catch on either. Somehow this platform, it's called the Ideal Platform, has become the kind of the consensus best way to sell bonds for underwriters to bid on, and so that's the platform that we use.
Thank you.
I would like to take this opportunity to give a shout out to Brian and the Zions team, as well as our own internal finance team. I had the opportunity to watch this a little bit from a distance, and I think these rates are a result of great work internally and some fabulous coaching and hand-holding on the part of Brian and the Zions team that positioned us here. And we enjoy our relationship, Brian, and appreciate all your work on our behalf.
Thank you, Mayor Curtis. As we did previously, we'll open this item for public comment. Any who would like to speak to this item may approach the podium. If there's no public comment, we'll bring the item back to the council for a motion. Mr. Sewell, motion to approve?
Yes. Move to approve.
Thank you. A second? Mr. Van Buren, thank you. Those in favor? The item passes unanimously with Mr. Hales excused. Next, we will consider a resolution appropriating $95,000 in the Economic Development Department of the General Fund for operating expenses related to providing a construction loan for the startup building project and applying to the fiscal year ending June 30th, 2015. This item will be presented by Dixon Holmes, Economic Development Chief Deputy. Mr. Holmes, welcome.
Thank you, Chair and Council members. This item is related to the next item on the agenda, which is an RDA item. It's a combination of funds. I believe you have a memo from the staff, and I'm prepared to answer any questions that you may have, but for the general public, the benefit to them, the Provo City, the Mayor's Office of Economic Development, has been involved for some time now in the startup community. These are early stage businesses that we hope someday will be very large businesses. The challenge is we don't know which ones are the ones that are gonna make it big and which ones are not, but we try to take an approach of a facilitating, connecting some of the dots for all of these businesses. And one of the things that many of these early stage businesses need is a place to work. And a lot of times you'll hear the word, well, we need an incubator. Well, a vacant building is not necessarily an incubator. It's and it may even be free, but free is never quite free. Someone's got to pay the utilities for the heating and cooling and all that. But anyway, so our office has been involved with a group called the Startup Group, the Taylor family. They are owners of a building located at 6 South and 100 West. You may also affectionately know it as the food truck roundup location. And if you haven't been there, a little plug for that group. On any Thursday night during the year, rain or shine, they have awesome food truck food there. But it is also the old or the former Startup Candy building, which has been making candy at that location for many years now. But a portion of that building owned by the Taylors has been converted from office space to co-working space. It is also the home of Dev Mountain, which is a code academy where a coding school where people can learn how to program. There are several such facilities in our community. But this startup building. It's being used currently on the main level for some manufacturing space, and the purpose of this loan would be to convert that manufacturing space to additional co-working space and small office space and event space for these startup businesses in our community. Our staff is proposing combining a portion or this $95,000 with some additional money from the RDA funds for a total of $200,000 as a loan, as a construction loan, for a term of 5 years at no interest. And that might seem, well, why aren't we trying to get our money back? Well, we want the principal back, but again, to facilitate the construction and the conversion of this space that has currently a business in there now, that business would have to leave, and that conversion would take place. And frankly, these kind of ventures, they need some backing, they need some patience, they need some money that may be possibly at risk. The city will lean the building for the $200,000. That will be our security is in the building. The building has a much larger value than what we have at risk, and so we're comfortable with that. We've had a good working relationship there. And frankly, the city approached the Taylors a number of years ago and asked them if they would consider making their building available. I guess other building owners would say, hey, how come you're not doing this deal with us? Well, frankly, this was space that the startup community kind of self-selected based on the quirkiness of the building. That group tends to like exposed brick and hardwood floors next to the Front Runner station near downtown. And so it really seems to be an ideal location for such a place to move forward. And so again, here tonight, representing the Mayor's Office of Economic Development, requesting appropriation of the funds that would end up being part of a larger loan package to the startup group for the conversion of the space.
Thank you, Mr. Holmes. We appreciate your work on this, an important issue. Are there questions from the council for Mr. Holmes? Mr. Miller.
Hi. Mr. Sewell.
Mr. Sewell.
Can you tell us what the current amount of incubator space is now and what it will be after the expansion?
Yeah, so right now the building has three levels. Mm-hmm. The upper, the second and third floor are being used by Dev Mountain. Again, that's the coding school. I guess the good challenge that we have is Dev Mountain has become so successful, they've actually expanded the space that they need, and the co-working space is being crowded a bit. And again, with the manufacturing space on the first level, that space again will be relocated elsewhere, and the main level of the building will be converted to that co-working space, small office space. So again, co-working space is where you might come in for the day, you might rent it for the month, you don't have a dedicated office space. It's, you might have some tables and chairs, you'll have Wi-Fi access, you know, obviously power. But you come back tomorrow, you may be sitting 10 feet to the left or the right. It's not dedicated to your so it's co-working. There may be any number of businesses working on different business ventures at that time. A portion of the building will be dedicated to that, but also another portion of the building will be set up for small businesses. So if you need to have some privacy, you're working on a deal, maybe you're not wanting a lot of input from other people. You need something, you can close the door, you can actually hang your stuff on the wall, then you can claim it to be yours. You can come back tomorrow, you can lock it and leave it. The footprint of the building is about 12,000 square feet. About a third of that would be co-working space. A third of it would also be the small office, and another third of that would be the event space, which also is very critical for meetup opportunities for these young businesses to meet investors, other programmers, other people with similar interests, and that would be on the main level. So about a third of each would be co-working, small office, and event space.
Thank you. Ms. Santiago?
In the staff report, was made mention that the cabinet shop in the bottom floor was the mainstay for the financial viability of the startup building.
They have been the long-term paying tenant, yes.
Okay, so if they're gone, what are the guarantees that they'll be able to financially be able to meet their financial obligation in repaying that loan?
So the other going concern is the Dev Mountain, the Code Academy. They are a paying tenant. Again, they are a relatively new business. They have a good track record as far as training people to learn how to program and then place them for business. Part of this model is, again, the co-working space. If you want to drop in, you would pay a certain fee. If you want the dedicated space or the small office space, that would be another fee. And then if you want to rent the event space, that would be an additional charge. As far as what is the absolute guarantee, probably no more than any other landlord that would hope to sign tenants. Most of the tenants coming to the space are not going to get financial backing to secure a long-term loan for that space, and that's why it's a little bit of a risk on the city's part to put money against it, the building, but that's where we're leaning the building to secure our loan. So ironclad guarantee, there is none. In this environment with startup communities, there really isn't. So I guess we're asking you to trust us a little bit, but again, we are taking prudent measures. We're not just giving them the money and saying, we'll see you later. Again, it's a construction loan of which the city will be overseeing that with our building department as far as inspections to make sure that the money that they're requesting is adequate for what they need to do, and then leaning the building to secure the interest of our loan through a portion of the value of the building.
And then another follow-up question was the CDBG money, the facade grant money, we're planning on using some of that for the reconstruction. Is that going to go toward facade, or is that going to go toward interior of the bottom floor?
Okay, so we have several pots of money here. This evening we're dealing with a portion of this $95,000. Several years ago, the council appropriated $175,000 for building improvements in the downtown. That was not necessarily a facade renovation grant program, which is housed in the RDA department. Separate money, similar titles, similar outcomes with some of that money. That's federal money. This is general fund money. That money had not been used, and so again, we're asking to reprogram a portion of that money. And then that would be combined with some tax increment financing money from the RDA. That's how we get the $200,000. But the facade, this isn't specifically facade grant money. It was money that was put aside to do improvements in the form of a loan also in the downtown. And we've worked with several businesses but have not been able to close any of those deals. And so we've decided to make a request to reprogram a portion of that money.
Okay. And we know that the value of that building is $200,000, or do we know what the appraisal
of
the building
is? The recent appraisal was $2 to $3 million.
Was $2 to $3 million?
Yes.
And the lien is toward the whole building?
Well, our lien would be for $200,000.
For $200,000?
Yes.
But, okay. Thank you.
Sure.
Mr. Miller? How much money remains in that account?
So that would leave us, it's $175,000, so that would leave us $80,000.
So this is the first appropriation?
Yes, the other $80,000 that remains in that account we actually hope to use in the downtown, and we are working with a current business if we can come to terms with what they want to do, when, and how.
What is the legal status of the startup group?
Legal status.
You made several references to the startup group.
Okay, so I'm
curious to know what we're talking about here.
So as far as an LLC or a C Corp or they're an LLC. Thank you from the crowd.
Resolution reads, operating expenses related to providing a construction loan. Help me understand what that means.
I apologize if that was not clear. It is for a construction loan. So to pay a contractor to come in and make the necessary improvements in the building in the form of walls, studs, electrical, plumbing, and mechanical, anything related to that.
So above and beyond what the loan bears.
No, that is the construction loan. The $200,000, the $95,000 from the General Fund Economic Development, the $105,000 from the TIF financing from the RDA, the combination of that being $200,000 via a construction loan. My apologies if that's not clear.
And what is the relation of this facility, by the way, a very desirable facility given the current craze for such across the country and internationally. What's the relationship of this facility to the owner of the property?
Well, the Taylors own the building. Mm-hmm. They are operating it in conjunction with others as far as the day-to-day operations. They would be the one, again, receiving the construction loan. They would hire the contractor with oversight from the city, have the work completed, and then open up for business and having and attracting the businesses coming in to occupy that space.
Is the city paying rent, or has it leased the space from
the
property
city,
owner?
So the city does get benefit of the building of, one, having a facility like that in our community, of which we don't have to go out and rent that space. The city does have a previous relationship in the earlier conversion of this for about $18,000 a year that then allows us to have some events in the space, but it's not a formal rent. I can't go in and say, hey, the city now will now take this much space. So it's been part of the backstopping of the original deal that made the space available for the startup community. As before, it was just standard office buildings and manufacturing, and the city approached the Taylors. It was kind of an effort to provide this kind of work, co-working space in the community.
We have an agreement as to how long?
That was a three-year. That was
a three-year agreement.
Yes, and so we're about a year and a half into that.
So we are making $200,000 available to the owners of the building.
For construction purposes.
For construction to meet our particular requirements.
Yes, so a number of years ago there was a discussion of, there's a lot of things that happen in our community, some of which the city's really good at doing, some of which we're not so good at doing. Being a specific landlord to tenants and such, that's really not something that the private sector does that very well. But having space in our community for these early stage businesses, locations where these young businesses can go, that's in the interest of our city. It's consistent with our economic development strategic plan. Frankly, it's cheaper for us to have other people do that, and we can kind of fill the gap in some of those areas where we're not as efficient or as effective. Let the private sector do that, and then we can be cheering on the side. And some of that, oftentimes, that's with small portions of money to kind of close the gaps where the private sector is not able to.
So we are assuming that there will be no direct return on this investment, this $200,000.
There will be no line items in our budget that says, here is a return on our investment. Mm-hmm. But there really isn't one of those anywhere in our budget that says, here is the return on economic development, other than the goodwill and the businesses that see value in being in Provo because they see Provo as a supporter of this type of an effort.
How many years before you come back and say, oh, by the way, I just wanted you to know that we have now, in essence, repaid that entire loan?
Well, I hope I would be back in 5 years to say, here's the note paid in full.
Gotta be sooner than that.
Oh, that'd be nice, too. So again, it does beg the question of the larger effort of economic development in our community. What is the benefit of it? And part of the benefit is having name recognition. All of those accolades that Provo gets for number one or being in the top 10 are not because this is a terrible place to start a business. Again, those top 10 rankings that we receive are because not just what the city does, but because we promote that effort, we foster that effort, and businesses get that and they understand it. And there are a lot of business either starting or coming to Provo who want to be a part of that. So,
do you have a list of, I know of at least one, that has left the startup and gone off into the community, rented space, and developed their own businesses before? Do you know how many businesses have we actually kind of helped grow up and move to other places in Provo rather than other places in other cities?
Okay, so that is a process that we're actually underway of tracking that a little closer on where they go, where they leave to, and again, that is the goal, that they would leave, hopefully stay in Provo, but the leash sometimes is a bit long and sometimes not completely under our purview of where they land. There are no, and that's why, frankly, investing in a building, which we know will stay in our community, minus a tornado or something like that that might move it elsewhere, is that investment stays with the community. So as these businesses cycle through, in essence, our investment continues to stay in place and help those businesses. So there have been many businesses that have become successful and secured additional financing that have started in this area or have been associated with the startup group and then go on to bigger and better things. But we're in the process of tracking that. I don't have any specific numbers, but would be happy to report back to the council another time some of those success stories.
But I do appreciate the relationship that you develop with those younger, with those new startup companies. And the relationship that you have with Provo makes them much more inclined to stay in Provo. And I'm grateful for that.
Well, it's all in a day's work, I guess.
And to be able to see those successes, Dixon, I think it would be helpful at a future date to know some of the success stories and where they land and what kind of employment we're talking about, what it's relating to.
Happy to do that.
It helps in decisions like these to know what the potential outcome is. Other questions or comments, Mr. Sewell?
I see a lot of value in these kind of incubator spaces. There's just a real vibe and energy there, both over the startup building and over in the startup dojo and Mr. Wendernan's building. I just had one last question about supply versus demand. It seems like in doing this, we're making the assumption that, you know, if we want to expand the amount of incubator space, that the demand is there. Do you have any evidence to support that?
So part of this expansion is a result of the Taylors coming to us and saying, we think the long-term viability, one, in this area of our economy is being driven by people seeking out this kind of space. Mm-hmm. The city has been approached by a number of other groups saying, hey, we would like to get into this co-working space, and to that we applaud. There is a challenge that, yes, if we suddenly have five of these come on at one time, that we could have a bit of a glut. And what we're saying is this is a group that we've been working with for a number of years. We're comfortable with that relationship. We'd like to see it continue based on the track record that we have. And at some point when we're done here, we would see then supporting other such facilities as the demand increases. It's our hope that, frankly, we would have five or six of these type facilities in our community. One of the challenges is there just aren't a lot of buildings that have that demand for that quirky kind of space, because frankly, as beautiful as the Newskin building is, they don't want that kind of space. These early stage businesses want stuff that is a little bit gritty, a little bit messy, and kind of under construction or whatever, and so that's the demand that they're seeing. And so again, the Taylors came to us and said, this is what we'd like to do, this is the gap that we have, and this is based on their perceived demand and what we have also recognized also in the number of people looking for this kind of space.
Thank you. Ms. Santiago?
I appreciate having this in our community too. I appreciate the an opportunity for these businesses to percolate and to, in fact, my neighbors, boys in my neighborhood, have gone to the 100 million cups and presented their
100 million cups would be a lot of cups.
Or 100, yes. What is it? 1 million cups?
1 million cups.
Okay. Well, I haven't been there yet, so as you can tell.
The sock guys?
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah, yeah.
They were awesome.
Yeah, the Doyles. And so, anyway, I want to attend, and I wanted to attend that day, but it's a hard time for me. But I appreciate that. I've watched them, these entrepreneurs, these teenage entrepreneurs, you know, get a little lift, and I really love that we have that here and that opportunity. You mentioned something about the private sector being better at being landlords. I'm, you know, paraphrasing your words horribly, but when you said that, I started to think of, in your staff report, the fact that you mentioned that the banks won't take this risk. And I started to think, well they're the experts in construction loans, and they won't take the risk. So I want to know why, as a city, we should, maybe just a little more explanation of why we should take the risk. And then I also think about the building. If we have a lien on the building for $200,000, but the building's worth $2 to $3 million, who would ever exercise the lien on the building? Who would, as a city, is that going to be hard for us? I guess this is a question for legal and a question for you. Just a little more
sure.
Information on why this would be worth it for the city to get involved in the construction loan business, I guess, is what I'm wondering.
So first of all, my intent is not to bring back a bunch of these. And because this is really new territory, we as the mayor's office have not brought you a bunch of these either. So we don't have this track record of saying, oh, well, this is the 15th or umpteenth of these that we have done. What the city does have a track record in, and many of you are familiar with this, is that we did at one point have a business development corporation, the BDC, and we used federal money that had certain strings attached to it that we would make gap financing loans to many early stage businesses who in similar situations could not secure funding because they were not bankable, didn't have enough assets, not enough revenue, they were too early, any number of reasons. And the city felt that it was important at the time to fund those businesses, again, not all of the financing, but a portion of that, so these businesses could get going. And for the 20 years that the city did that, our track record was about 75% payback. So it was not 100%, and some of the money did not come back. It was revolving, it was a loan, and so the money, most of that money was paid back up to 75% on the loans that we did. So again, the city is not necessarily looking to get into the construction loan business, but similar to the improvements in the facade grants and loans that are made available in the downtown for the public interest of making that money available to shop owners who tend to be mom and pop operations, not big corporations, so they can go in and improve their building. In a similar manner, this money is being made available to basically a mom and pop property owner who are willing to put their building at risk also. This is a risky venture for them too, recognizing that the tenants that they're attracting are not bankable tenants. Mr. Winterton owns a similar type facility, a bit smaller, and most of the businesses that are in that facility are also early stage. It's called the Startup Dojo. It's on University Avenue. So again, we're not looking to wholesale. One, we don't want to compete with banks. They're absolutely right. There's things that we don't do real well, and frankly, I would not recommend that we do a lot of these. In this particular circumstance, to make this building available and viable, we think this is a good risk for what we're trying to accomplish as far as making this additional space available in our community in a building that already has name recognition and has a track record of providing co-working space for early stage businesses.
And Ms. Santiago, with regard to the lien, you know, it's up to the city to exercise the lien. So if we have the lien against the property and the loan is not being paid back, it's up to us to go seek a court order ordering them to sell the property. And if that occurs, then we get the money back from the loan out of the proceeds of the sale, assuming that the sale makes at least that money and there aren't other lien holders that in a higher priority than us.
So again, our first approach, even when we had the business development corporation, if someone came in and said, hey, having a hard time making my payment this month, our first is not conversation with the attorneys. It's like, okay, well, when can you pay it? How much can you pay? And so we try to work that out. And in most cases, well, at least 75% of the time with the business development corporation, we were able to get payback on the loan.
Yeah, so I guess that was my question, or my thought is that if they're not able to pay back the loan, what are the chances that we would do what we'd had to do to get them to, make good on their commitment? But
well,
that's a question for
that's
the future
a good question.
If we decide to do this.
But. Yeah, it's a policy question. You know, the most recent example of that, which it was in a very different situation, was the Roasted Artichoke building, where we obtained a court order to be able to take the building down for safety purposes, and we obtained a lien on the property, and then did exercise that lien to try to get some of the costs back that we had expended in taking the building down. But it would just be a policy decision at the moment as to whether or not the benefit of recovering those proceeds was worth whatever downsides there were to going forward with exercising the lien.
Well, and taking away the space that we've come to really appreciate, the startup space that we have currently, the two floors, and the risk, I guess, is what I'm concerned about.
So again, the benefits of improving the building and not the business, again, I'm not suggesting that this is a grant, this is a loan, we do expect money to come back to us, is the building has been improved. If the building has a reputation as a good location to start a business because of the energy and the connectedness, whether it's the tailors that own the building or somebody else, we believe the investment will continue, similar to the investment that we make in downtown businesses. When we make a facade grant or loan, the general benefit to the public is that building has now been improved And yes, the city does want to get its money back on the facade grants in the downtown and the loans and such. But the public good, because now building is improved, it's more aesthetically pleasing, it's more attractive, it's more functional, it's more usable. We think that still has a public benefit. Again, I'm not suggesting that we turn this into a grant, but again, that is one of the upsides of that kind of a downside opportunity, is if it goes south or things go bad, that that we'd have the ability, the building is still there, it's still improved, and it can continue to be used for its intended purpose. And then the city would seek recourse for the repayment of the $200,000, whether that meant foreclosure or being cashed out. Those would be any number of alternatives we'd seek.
Other questions or comments?
One more question. Do you see this as being a very big competitive advantage for this company over some of the other private companies that are in, that are going on in our community, this type of business?
Most of the other businesses that have come and talked to us about this are talking in the millions of dollars of what it is to convert their space, because the space is so far different than what it currently wants to be as far as making it that co-working space. We have had meetings with groups that says we're going to go raise the $5 or $6 million, we'll bring in investors, and we tell them good luck with that, that's awesome, and hope that goes well, and we would welcome that. We haven't seen any of those come to be yet, but we've had lots of people come talk to us about it. It's a frequent conversation, and again, because of our initial investment, we believe that we're going in the right direction with the property owners and with a space that has a reputation of being conducive for that kind of space.
Thank you, Mr. Holmes. At this time, I invite any additional council discussion or comments or a motion. Mr. Sewell?
I've just been thinking back to when I started my business in my basement. And now it grew slowly over a period of years, and now we're employing about 45 people in the valley. And I was thinking, I'm not even sure we had incubator spaces back then, but if we did, if I had been able to move into a place like that and rub shoulders with other sharp entrepreneurs, I might have learned faster and grown faster. So I see a potentially very large economic benefit from supporting this. Of course, it is a risk, but I'm willing to extend that trust that Mr. Holmes' department asked for, and it feels to me like it's a risk worth taking. So I'd like to make a motion that we approve the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. Sewell. Is there a second?
I second the motion.
Mr. Miller, thank you. Those in favor of this resolution? Is there any additional discussion?
So I appreciate your comments, and having not been in the business myself, I see that there, you know, I'm sure in business you do take risks, but I like to, I don't know, I'm still grappling, I guess. I don't know if Mr. Van Buren, if you have input to on this at all, or if there's any more input. I need a minute longer to let it percolate, because I don't know that I'm quite ready to vote. But I appreciate the comments, and especially those who, you know, have been self-employed or do you know, as you say, you've been in their shoes, and I'd like to hear more.
I think one of the basis of our attitude and philosophy in our city is to be pro-startup, pro-new business, pro-entrepreneurs. And this is, at least since I've been on the council, been a key part of our economic development. And so I see this as a positive thing. It's had positive results so far. I think a little expansion. The risk is there, but the track record, if we're receiving 75% back on the old methods, I think this new method, I think the percentage will even be better. So I'm supportive of this, and I think it'll be a positive thing for economic development and also for development of new companies. So I would like to vote for the resolution.
Also, on the location of the spot, I don't see anything but the values of those properties going up because of our TOD type situation. And so I think even though there is some risk with the values of the properties there, I think we're not in a terribly difficult position.
Mr. Mayor, any comment?
Thank you. I really enjoyed Mr. Sewell's comments, and interestingly, I found myself asking those same questions as a BYU grad in 1985. If I had had this type of a resource, I actually do believe my career would have been very different. And I'm obviously a supporter. Another way to look at this, if you're struggling a little bit, is I'm thinking about the clamor we've had in our community over retail in the last couple of weeks, and some of the chatter is, why won't we incentivize these people to come to our city? Well, that's a whole nother dialogue. But in many respects, this is a quite conservative way to incentivize these businesses to be successful. So instead of handing them money that we never get back to incentivize businesses, this is actually has the potential to come back. And from that perspective, it's not so risky. And if you look at what we do in the economic development world to bring businesses into our city and the money that we or other cities will spend to make that happen, this is actually a very inexpensive way to bring economic development into the city.
Does everyone feel ready for a vote? All right, I'll call for a vote then. Those in favor? And the voting is unanimous, with Mr. Hales excused. I now call for a motion to recess as the Municipal Council and reconvene as the Redevelopment Agency of Provo. Moved by Mr. Miller, thank you. And a second by Mr. Van Buren, thank you. Those in favor? That vote is unanimous. We'll turn the time then to our Redevelopment Agency Vice Chair, David Sewell.
Thank you. So we have the second part of this, a resolution appropriating $200,000. And just, well, I guess you'll clarify this when you come up, but it sounded like that's a cumulative number rather than adding to the previous $95,000. Anyway, we'll turn the time over to Dixon Holmes and David Walter to explain this to us.
Dave, go ahead and address this. Mr. Vice Chair and agency members, good evening. The item tonight, the mechanics of the loan actually would be your previous item appropriated $95,000, which would then be transferred into the Redevelopment Agency Tax Increment Fund and combined with $105,000 from our fund balance, and then the agency technically would make the loan to the startup company, take out the lien, and then, you know, as the payments come in, we would pay back the general fund first. With through the finance department, there would be a note that general fund would hold, and we would be obligated to pay back. So in order to ameliorate the risk that the general fund faced in making this loan, the redevelopment agency would be the entity that's going to take out the loan and take out the lien against the property. This became an opportunity for us to have a public-private partnership that would foster the entrepreneurial spirit in Provo and not put us in the position that we're making individual loans to the startup businesses and we have to pick and choose who wins and who doesn't get the cash. And so as the money comes in, this may be an opportunity for us to create a similar revolving loan fund if it does work out. But we would anticipate that the general fund gets paid back first, the redevelopment agency then would get paid back after the general fund is made whole.
Thank you. Are there any questions?
Which of your funds would the $105,000 come from?
This is our fund balance. So as we've been accumulating tax increment funds from the county for a period of time, this has gone to our fund balance. And so this is not taking away money that's going currently to a project, but is available to be appropriated as the agency sees fit.
Thank you.
I might just point out, Ms. Santiago, that might take a little, give it a little relief to the $95,000 that you had a question before, that it's going to be paid back first. And so if this loan did fail, if worst case scenario, the $95,000 will be the first part back. So I think that gives us a little more protection to the general fund.
I agree.
Is there further discussion on this item? Then I'll entertain a motion.
Mr. Sewell, I'll make a motion to approve the resolution.
Thank you. Mr. Van Buren. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Thank you, Mr. Winterton. All in favor? The motion passes unanimously with Mr. Hales excused. I call for a motion to adjourn the Redevelopment Agency of Provo meeting and reconvene as the Municipal Council of Provo meeting. Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sewell. We'll now continue with a public hearing on an ordinance amending the zone map classification from A15 agriculture to R18 one family residential for approximately 35 acres of real property located generally at 680 West, 1560 South for a future subdivision. And we'll turn to Bill Pepperoni for this item.
Thank you. So as was said, this is a rezone request for 35 acres of property approximately from the A15 zone to R18. The property is located down on 1560 South, just west of 500 West. This is 500 West here. The alignment for the new West Side connector is close to this property and to the south of it. We can go to the next slide. As you can see from the map, we've got R18 zoning to the east. We have R110 zoning to the north. The zone they've asked for is the R18, but their housing density is right about 3 units to the acre, which is really very consistent with R110 zoning. Their lots range in size from 8,400 square feet to 14,000. The average lot size is about 9,500. Go to the next slide. This shows you the layout for the subdivision. They've agreed to, the developers have agreed to mass open space along the south and west sides of the property because as the southwest master plan is in the process of being developed, it has appeared that this is the best place to put open space in order to have a trail system that will connect further to the west. You'll see how that will connect in as the master plan develops. Some of the attributes of this plan are that they did not take the larger lots and put them in one section. They tried to divide them around, which would allow for a variety of house styles and sizes throughout the neighborhood, which I think is a good feature. If you look at the road layout and the way streets are broken up, I think that's a really good plan, a really smart plan. And the reason for that is if you have too many long straight streets like that, that's when people tend to build up speed as they drive to the neighborhood. By having shorter segments and forcing turn movements, you slow the traffic down through the neighborhood. So even though that's their longest street, continuous street, they have four-way intersections here and there, and those also help to slow down traffic as you come to that four-way intersection. So I think they've done a very good job in designing this so that it's a friendly place to live in as much as possible. Next slide, or that may be the last. So there's just the zoning map that we've already talked about. It's the A15 zone now. Next. Okay, that's the end of the slides. That's all I have in my presentation. The Planning Commission voted to approve this by 4-3 votes. That's all I have.
Thank you, Mr. Pepperoni. Questions for Mr. Pepperoni? Mr. Sewell?
I don't recall, Mr. Pepperoni, what was the staff recommendation on this?
Staff recommendation was for approval.
Thank you.
Ms. Santiago?
So
I don't know, maybe you mentioned this. I'm sorry if you did. They talked about the trail and the open space, and that was that the city was going to be responsible for the upkeep of that trail? And if so, is Parks and Recs, or who will upkeep that, and who's responsible for the liability and those kinds of things? If you could just address that, I would appreciate it.
Yeah, the developer has agreed to dedicate the open space and improve it, and the Parks Department has agreed to maintain that. The Parks Department will be very involved in the design of the park space so that it's not labor intensive to maintain. But we have had specific meetings with the Parks Department over this trail system and have made sure that they're in agreement with what the plans are.
And then Brian, I guess if you could address the liability part of that.
Sorry, the what?
The liability, the city liability part of, or if any, with the trail being, I don't know, is this something that we typically do with developments?
The only liability is going to be over the improvement of the trail itself. You know, the fact that there's an easement or something there, it isn't in and of itself going to create liability. If the city then constructs a trail and somebody gets injured because we constructed it badly or maintained it poorly, then we could have liability that way. But does that answer your question? Okay.
This might be for Dave, but there was some concerns on the Planning Commission about water table and water issues in that area. Do you have any responsibility for those? And can you see any real challenges with that?
Thank you. I spoke with Bill. That was one of the questions that the Planning Commission did raise, and we do have a limit. The compromise level of the Utah Lake is 4495, and by city ordinance, we require all builders to build a foot above that elevation, and that is consistent throughout the west side. So basements are unlikely in this area, and they will be building above that compromise level.
One of the things that I understand a little bit of the concern with smaller lots, but on the other hand, I hope that the developer will put in homes rather than having to pay for more ground. They'll be able to have nicer homes. And so is there any plans for the type of home that will go in there?
I'll let Dave, Mr. Gardner, answer questions about home plans and their desires in that way. I guess in my mind, one thing that gives me some comfort is that there is such a small supply of single family lots in the city anywhere right now. I think that's going to push prices on the lots up, and I think that's going to push prices on the homes up. And I'm not real worried about the size of the lot dictating a small house or inexpensive house, just because I think the price of the lots, the demand for the lots will be high enough that I think we're going to be pleased with what gets built. But Mr. Gardner can give you more details than I can.
We'd welcome the developer to present any information he has or share with us his thoughts.
My name is Dave Gardner. We're the developer of this property. The master plan calls for this to be residential zoning, and our mix of lots, we range from, the majority of the lots are 9,000 to 10,000 square feet. So our intent is to develop this with a builder, and the house plans that we've submitted for the design are just under 2,000 square feet. They're four bedrooms. They fit on our smallest lot, which isn't that small. And we are excited about this project because we're hitting it at the right time. We usually have very bad timing in the development business, but I think in this one, we might be lucky. we're ahead of the game on other people doing developments on the west side. We really like the location. The open space issue came up early because the staff has been doing a master plan process for the whole west side, and including Footprinter Park and trails and all kinds of things, even the trail tying in with the collector road that's going in. And that's one of the nice things about this is this, the open space comes down this way, over this way, and then connects. There's a, I think it's about a 7-acre parcel that's owned by the Division of Wildlife that's heavily wooded, and that goes all the way down to the collector road. The staff has been trying to work with Division of Wildlife to swap that land. We have offered land south of the collector road in exchange, a 2-to-1, 3-to-1, whatever we need to do to get that property. We have expressed our willingness to donate that property to the Division of Wildlife if they will give that in turn to the city. So that that would make a nice connection. Now, that's not the full trail system, but you'll get that incrementally as development occurs. And you don't have very far to go to get to Footprinter's Park, and then that will be a nice amenity for the whole west side. I don't know if I need to go into the traffic was a concern. I can go into that, but it's the traffic study shows that we can handle this, and no houses have to be taken out to widen roads. We're in good shape. The water table, this did not get underwater in 83 and 84 when we had our biggest flood in decades. This was not under, did not have any standing water on it. So we do have a high water table, and but we have agreed to the elevation requirements of Provo City. That's standard requirement for anything on the west side with high water table. So are there any questions that I can?
Questions for Mr. Gardner. Mr. Winterton?
Not for Dave Gardner, for Dave Decker. One more time. Did you say we didn't reach that in 83 and 84 during our high flood season? Do we ever reach the compromise point as far as flooding goes in that part of town?
I don't have the exact elevation as far as where the water table went on this particular property in 1983. I do have information further to the east. I know even up close to our treatment plant, we had water that far east. It was pretty significant. There is a dike system. I don't know if it was in place on this particular property. It may not have existed at that time. But those elevations vary, obviously, you know, on the west side, and we require that compromise level, that compromise flood zone in every single subdivision on the west side. There's a few locations where a split level home might be able to be built with, you know, a basement in it, but that ordinance is enforced on every single subdivision on the west side.
Mr. Miller?
Mr. Pepperoni, do you care to speak to the...
In just a moment, we'll open to public comment. In just a moment. in just a moment, we'll open for public comment.
I get the opportunity to speak in church Sunday, so I thought I'd practice my oratory skills. But I'm Terry Herbert. I'm the Lakewood Neighborhood Chair.
Mr. Herbert, the meeting hasn't been opened for public hearing yet. Chair Garrett said he would do that in just a moment, but if you could have a seat for just a moment, we're not ready to take public comment yet.
I just wanted to speak as neighborhood chair.
Right, you'll have the first opportunity.
He's going to give you a moment in just a second, but he wasn't done up here yet.
Okay.
So we'll give you a second moment in just a second.
That's fine. You'll be first to go.
I wonder, Mr. Pepperoni, if you are inclined to speak about plans for Fifth West.
Again, I think that's probably a better question for Dave. It's my understanding that the amount of asphalt that is there now is what's required for a road of that classification. The improvements to Fifth West that residents have expressed concern in, it's my understanding, have more to deal with segments of sidewalk that are missing than it is asphalt that's missing. Further north, where I'm pointing now, you have a lot of the older homes that have been there for way before we had requirements for sidewalks on the roads. So you have sections of sidewalk that are missing. I think it's that the residents are expressing their concern over, but again, Mr. Herbert would also know what their concerns are.
Thank you. Any other questions for Mr. Pepperoni or Mr. Gardner? Mr. Sewell? Turn your mic on, please.
Thank you. I have a question for Mr. Gardner. One of the concerns raised in the Planning Commission comments, they were talking about lot size, and it sounds like your proposal has a pretty good mix of sizes, and actually a fairly small number that are the minimum size. But the concern that was raised is if something happened and another developer ended up taking over the project, that the, and we had changed the zone, then they, the whole development could be built at the minimum size. Is there, do you have any comment about that concern?
Yeah, let's just all pray I don't die. I don't know what, I would hate to be the developer that comes back to you and say, I want to do all 8,000 square foot lots. I mean, that isn't going to go over well. So I personally don't see that as a problem, because another developer would have to be an idiot to do that. Take that back. There are developers that are that. But for the exact numbers, we have 29 lots out of the 144 that are between 8,000 and 9,000 square feet. 72 lots are the 9,000 to 10,000 square foot. And then after that, we've got six lots that are 10, one lot that's 11 plus, five lots that are 12 plus, and one lot that's 14. So we've tried to make a mix, and we tried to do it so that they weren't all in one location. We spread them around. But even the house that I was just describing, the just under 2,000 square foot, four bedroom home, that's without a basement, you know, that can fit on our I don't think we have anything under 8,400, but on our smaller lot. And that's a home that's big enough for people to move into and actually have their children go to high school here in Provo instead of having them go to the elementary school and moving to another city for them to go to high school. So that's the market we think is out there, and that's the market we hope to tap.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gardner. And now we'll open this issue for public hearing. Starting with you, Mr. Herbert, we'd like to invite you forward. I'm sorry I didn't make the process very clear. Please take the microphone, Terry.
Thank you again. I'm Terry Herbert, Lakewood Neighborhood Chair. And as I've heard these questions, fortunately or unfortunately, I was working for the city in irrigation and storm drain in 1983-84. And so I had the opportunity to be down there on a number of occasions while all this flood water was going on. The Corps of Engineers came in and built a dike along the south side of the property with an elevation of 4497, and along the west side of the property at an elevation of 4495. The compromise level, Utah Lakes, 4489-45. I hate to bore you with numbers, but the flood waters got to an elevation of 4495. So had the dikes not have been there, that property would have been underwater. There was some water from infiltration and percolation, but nothing serious. So what we've done, I had the opportunity to sit on the West Side Steering Committee. As we looked at these, one of the recommendations that was made is finished floor elevations on that particular property be at 4496, which is 1 foot above the flood level of 83-84, and recognizing that there could still be some infiltration, percolation as the level of the lake comes up or goes down, but that's where we're at right now. As far as drainage, on that particular piece of property, there is one spring, but it's not contiguous to Utah Lake, so that makes it non-jurisdictional, and it's not subject to the Wetlands Mitigation Act, but they do have to put drainage in there to drain that out in the way, and I'm sure that Mr. Decker and the crews will address those kind of things when the time comes. Since 2007, I've been the neighborhood chair, and we've had 5 neighborhood meetings on the development of this particular piece of property. And almost all the comments have been the same. One of the concerns was the homes will be too small, worried about traffic, sidewalks, stormwater, sewer water, and those other things. Those have been all recorded and sent to Planning Commission as well as to the City Council. I do not take sides one way or the other. I've been accused of taking sides, but I remind people that I'm just the facilitator. And when I hear and heard about, I've been told a number of times that was completely underwater in 83, 84. But sometimes the facts really ruin a good story, because when I went out to my pickup and got the aerial photos for that period of time and showed no water, it changed things a little bit. But I just wanted to give you my perspective and let you know where we're at. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Herbert. We appreciate that report. Could you also, you said there have been a number of neighborhood meetings and several issues have been raised. What's the general sentiment or feeling from the neighbors related to this specific project?
The last meeting we had quite a large number out. We had 60 of the neighborhood neighbors down there come out to the meeting. But the comments were basically the same for all of them. They want to make sure that sufficient sewer is put in, curb and gutter, sidewalk, traffic controls, make sure the storm water is taken care of, and they have adequate culinary water. And I know for a fact that on 1560 South, that sewer line is 36 inch, so that's a big sewer line. But again, I'm sure Mr. Decker and engineering will address those issues if and when they come up.
So not necessarily anti-development, just wanting to make sure that these issues are addressed through the process.
There are a handful somewhat anti-development, just because they don't want to see that developed down in that area. They like the urban area, the rural area, where it's open and you got the birds and everything down there. We hear that at every meeting. But when I moved down in that area 37 years ago, none of it was developed south of where I live. And when they wanted to develop south, I was one of them at the meeting that didn't want any development down there. And had I been successful, the people at these last meetings wouldn't have been there. So what we're trying to do is, as neighborhood chair and neighbors, it's going to develop eventually. We just want to get the best bang for the buck.
Okay. I'm curious, Mr. Herbert, if your property is represented on this map here. Are you that close to the development?
Oh, no, I'm...
You're farther north?
I'm north of there, about 5 or 6 blocks.
Okay. Thank you again, Mr. Herbert. Okay. Continuing our public comment, we'd like to invite any other members of the public who would like to speak to this issue to approach the podium.
Brian Smith, Lakewood Neighborhood, Provo. I won't take long because Terry, Mr. Herbert's done a great job representing what went on in those meetings. You'll hear the neighbors talk a lot about lot sizes and that kind of thing, because they think it directly relates to their property values and that kind of thing. Also, transient neighborhood with smaller lot sizes, R18 versus R110. The Lakewood neighborhood, frankly, is a transient neighborhood. It's a newlywed or nearly dead, just about. with a few of us in the middle in there, but it is very, there's a lot of rentals, and they're afraid of it becoming more so if this goes through. But I think the biggest thing, at least for me, and I do live just up Fifth West, main corridor here, where the speed limit is 25, but really it's 45 or 50. So traffic calming measures on 1560 and on 500 are my main issue with that large of a development. Although it would be staged, I know that, and that would be a good thing, but with, I almost wish it would all go in at one time. That way the traffic would quadruple, quintuple, and then you wouldn't be able to drive 40 miles an hour on those roads. There'd be so much traffic. It would have to go slow. But traffic on 500 and on 1560 are already, the speeds are already fast, and I know we've heard it's an enforcement issue, and it is, but infrastructure, you know, needs to be monitored closely if this goes through, where, you know, the minute it hits any kind of a red zone in the amount of traffic that those two roads will hold, something needs to be done with those roads as far as widening or traffic calming measures or something like that. So that's my only concern. I like the presentation as it's been presented at R18. It's got several 10,000 square foot lots in there, and there's a lot of variation. It doesn't look cookie cutter from the plan, and I think that the neighborhood in general say, you know, if it's going to go in, and it's going to go in, we just want the best plan possible and the infrastructure to handle all of it. So, yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smith.
Dave Connect, Provo South Neighborhood Chair. My comments relate to the timeliness of this project, and it finally is time, at least when it comes to access. About 10 years ago, this came up with Anderson Development, and it was voted down, and they sued the city about it. But it was all about access, that we didn't have another way under the freeway, we didn't have the road out to the airport. And those issues are important because, as Brian said, we have traffic that will be going through the neighborhood, and back then all of it would have gone through the neighborhood without any other outlets. The other thing that I like about this project is the west side has always had an issue with small homes and not having something in the neighborhood that you could move up into. Instead, you had to just move out. So having a mix of homes in the development is really a great example of how it should be done. And I also like the layout of the roads. You don't have people just speeding through the neighborhood. It has the layout and the four-way stops that would discourage that. So hopefully we get a good result here. It looks very promising.
Thank you, Mr. Connect.
I'm Ben Markham. I don't have much voice tonight. I don't know what happened to it. I'm here, or I'm making a comment in this particular topic as the TMAC chairman. We've had several discussions in TMAC that kind of bordered on transportation from the west to the east and vice versa in Provo. And there's a general feeling that we're not quite there yet, and even if we look at the longer range plans, there's still some question. I look at this and see a lot of nice homes, but I don't understand, and it's just my own fault for not having followed this more closely. If I lived there and worked in the city, how would I get to work? And I'll leave that question for one of these gentlemen to answer. But I think it's important for us. I'm in favor of this development. I think it's the right kind of thing for Provo. The comments about mixed-size lots and single-family dwellings, I'm in favor of the development. I want to make sure that we're giving enough thought to infrastructure, not just sewage lines and stormwater lines, but the overall transportation plan for the west side.
Thank you, Mr. Markham. And while Mr. Pepperoni is coming back to the podium, could you put back up the map that shows the actual development with the lots and lot sizes and roads? Thank you.
Mr. Markham always keeps us on our toes. He's a very valuable member of the TMAC. I think what he's referring to is the limited opportunities we have to make east-west movements across the I-15. It's my assumption that most people who came out of this development would simply go up 500 west, up into the city center, or even further north. And not the too distant future, the West Side Connector will connect in just to the south. And when that does, the Fifth West will connect into it. And that will be an easy route out of the city going to the south, or even going onto the I-15 and heading north if that's what somebody would like to do. But it's most likely, I think they would use 500 West just to access the city center. Certainly we have been doing long-range planning, trying to look at alternatives to make better east-west connections. And that will be a big part of the general plan update and the transportation plan update that we'll be doing in the coming year. But he's asking a question I can't stand here and answer specifically. He knows that. That's why he put me on the spot. Don't worry, Ben, I'll get even, okay?
Thank you. Is there any other public comment?
My name is Cindy Richards. I live in Franklin neighborhood. I've seen four proposals on this piece of property in 20 years. First time was Planning Commission, the other three times were council member. For a number of reasons, this is the best proposal I've seen. And one big one is, over those 20 years, we saw the west side, a majority of the west side develop out at R18, just straight R18. And so many of those homes were two and three bedrooms. There has been a rental issue with that. But if you remember where the new elementary school is off of Geneva Road, northwest Provo, that was a planned high school. Kay, you'd know that. That was for a high school. But we just have families that were buying small homes as starter homes, and then they would grow out of them. Mike Maurer is a perfect example of that, you know. He grew out of his home. And then he also got a job in Salt Lake. But four bedrooms is a big deal and can really help a family stay in that home. And also the quality and the track record, the quality of the buildings and the track record of a developer that has developed in Provo and keeps their promises. So the ideas of bulb outs and things that are traffic calming, those things are just automatic in the kinds of developments that have been done on the west side and also in terms of these developers. I think it will really bless the area with longer-term residents, myself, and also with the access out over onto the freeway and, of course, up into the center of town. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Richards.
I just wanted to add that the traffic is not going to quadruple. The traffic study shows that we now have about, on 5th West, north of 1560, we have a relatively high volume for a residential street, 1,700 vehicle trips a day. We're going to be adding 1,400 to that, but this is a residential collector road, and that road is designed to handle 7,000 vehicle trips a day. So there is still plenty of room for something to occur down by the interchange that could end up drawing people from this neighborhood to that interchange.
Ryan,
all the rest are way under.
Excuse me, Mr. Gardner. Ryan, could you go back to the other map again? Sorry about that. Okay. Go ahead, Mr. Gardner.
This one?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so 5th West, current traffic count is 1,700 vehicle trips a day. and we're going to be adding 14 on this, 200 on this road. I can't remember the number on 1560, but we're well within the design guidelines that the city has adopted for streets and traffic volumes. A residential collector, this is the street that will feel the most impact, because right now it dead ends. And so the only people that come down this street is these few little neighbors in here. We're tying into these stub roads, and eventually the traffic pattern will change. The traffic engineer is saying right now most of the traffic is going to go north. But over time, when people get used to this road and how much time it'll save them, that traffic will start to split, and a lot of it will end up going south, getting on the freeway, or going east, going north or south. So we will be generating traffic, but you know, we heard a lot of this in the neighborhood meetings, and it's not going to be as bad as they think it is. So anyway, that's all.
There might be real merit in sharing the plan for Fifth West and the West Side Connector, just to show the number of lanes that will be added, both to Fifth West and the connector out to the interstate.
Actually, all that was going to be happening on Fifth West is you'll be taking the parking off the street and restriping it. It's not a huge expense. If you do that, you can handle up to 7,000 vehicle trips a day. And you have several residential collectors in the city now that function that way, and that saves the city a ton of money in widening out a road that you don't need to widen out. You just need to take the parking off the street.
But my point is, though, that they may be put at some ease by seeing what will come in the future, allowing them access both west to the airport but also to the interstate as a way of accessing the center of the city.
I think that's one of the reasons I'm so high on this property, is it is just going to be a matter of the commute to the freeway is going to be a minute and 15 seconds if it's heavy traffic. It's just going to be so nice to get right there and go.
Without question.
This is a great location. So
thank you, Mr. Gardner. Is there any other public comment? If not, we'll close public comment. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, thank you.
I'm Pam Argyle, and I'm the property that runs all along the property line to the west. And on the other map, it showed how many went out onto 1560. And I think that there will be a big traffic issue, because out of that 117 homes in there, there's going to be a lot of elementary students. And people are going to be driving their children to school. And I'm assuming, I'm not sure, and perhaps you could, is that district going to be going to Sunset View, or will they be going to Franklin? Because now my children have to go to Sunset View, and I'm right on that. And so I don't know if it will split or not, but that's another thing to consider, is that we have all of that traffic. So I know that they're saying that the traffic isn't going to be an issue, but I believe it's going to be the main issue. We're not opposed to people living there, but we are very concerned about the traffic as neighbors in the area. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Argyle. If there's no other public comment, we'll close public comment and bring the discussion back to the council for any other questions or comments or reactions. Or a motion.
I feel like all of my questions have been satisfied on this development, and I feel that it is what we're looking for in our city in a lot of ways, having a diverse use of our diverse mix of homes, home sizes, and it is surrounded by R18 on the top and R110 on the side, and I think it looks like a great project, and we do have a reputable developer, and I like the green space. I like the connectivity, the possibilities of connectivity with the trail. I am very favorable towards it.
I'm also pretty confident in our engineers on handling traffic calming issues should they come up and should it become a challenge? I know that sometimes with traffic it's difficult because I know most planners plan for what's there rather than what could be. And I think that we've looked at what could be, and I think we're aware of opportunities to calm some of that traffic in the future. And I think I have confidence in them. And I think if you continue to work with them, you'll find that they'll help you make sure you have the traffic calming issues you need.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to make a motion to approve the ordinance amending the zone map as it's written.
Thank you, Mr. Van Buren. Is there a second? Ms. Santiago, thank you. Those in favor of the motion? The motion passes unanimously with Mr. Hale excused. Thank you. We'll now turn to the next item on our agenda, which is a resolution encouraging the state of Utah to address comprehensive transportation funding. And this resolution will be presented by Council Executive Director Matt Taylor.
Being passed before you is the most recent draft of the transportation funding resolution that was discussed in today's work session. It should reflect what you saw in the actual meeting. For the public's benefit, this is a resolution, proposed resolution, being requested by the Utah League of Cities and Towns to, they've requested of all member cities of the league, which is over 240 cities, if I remember correctly, to encourage the legislature to adopt additional transportation funding options this legislative session. Two current ideas are either a general increase in the gas tax or a local option sales tax that municipalities could adopt at their discretion. That is not to say that those two options are the only ones that could be considered during this legislative session. There may be others. This resolution from the Provo City Council essentially says that the city is supportive of efforts of the legislature to diversify the number of tools that cities have at their disposal to be sufficient in their transportation needs.
Thank you, Mr. Taylor. Does anyone have any questions for Mr. Taylor or other comments or remarks they'd like to make relative to this resolution? Mr. Winterton.
I think Chairman of TMAC ought to have a copy of this resolution because I think that does affect us. So I'd like you to take that, Ben, and just have a look at it. But I do think that this is an opportunity for options for our city, even though we have worked really hard and I think done a pretty darn good job of solving some of our own problems.
Thank you, Mr. Winterton. Other comments? Mr. Mayor?
I don't have an opportunity to vote for you, with you, so I would like to express my support of this resolution. And should it be sent in the form that gives an opportunity to include my signature, I'd be pleased to do so.
Great, thank you. Anyone else? I know we had a lengthy discussion during our work session related to this resolution and the opportunity we have to join other cities and towns that make up our league in promoting a resolution that would invite the legislators in our state to provide cities with more tools to finance or pay for road improvement and transportation needs within their cities. So largely this is a resolution in support of that effort by the Utah League of Cities and Towns. If
If there's no other comment, I'll look for a motion. Mr. Markham, you're welcome to make a comment. Yes, as the...
Thank you. turn a clock on, Matthew. I have too many thoughts about this. I think one of the critical elements of any transportation funding plan is it needs to have a pay-as-you-go component. The two main things that are being talked about by the legislature do indeed do that, though the pay part in the sales tax type thing can be argued to be more of a regressive tax than the straight fuel tax type thing. There's a fuel tax opportunity. It makes a lot of sense. I personally, and as a TMAC chair, would support more of a mention of that as a preferred large element. There can be multiple elements, but if you look at fuel tax, Utah is relatively low. We are the same as our neighbors until you go west, but we're relatively low across the nation. And there is room for a fairly significant increase. What's going to happen to the price you pay for fuel, gasoline, and diesel? It's going to go up as Tier 3 gasoline comes in. Tier 3 gasoline is good, but it's going to cost 10 cents a gallon. If you look at the history of diesel, diesel was 50 cents a gallon below gasoline 25 years ago. It's 50 cents above gasoline now. The difference is they took all the sulfur out of diesel, and as they do that with gasoline, you're going to see a significant raise. It's not, gasoline's already down some, so it's not 50 cents or a dollar, but it's a significant deal. It is interesting to see that crude oil prices are 50 bucks or so now. They've been up around 100 for a long time. The supply demand of crude oil is such that there's OPEC greed. Nobody wants to close their valve. They all want the most income they can get. North America's had tremendous success. North America's energy independent. The United States is not quite there yet, but if you throw in Canada and Mexico, we're actually fully energy independent. And there's a slump in demand growth because the Asian economies have slumped, and I don't know how long that'll last. Add that all up, and gasoline prices are probably closer to where they're going to be over the next several years than where they were for a few years before that, which means, in my mind, there's an opportunity for us to use transportation tax, fuel tax, as a way to raise revenue to, and I'd like to see this kind of revenue earmarked for maintenance and construction of transportation infrastructure. That leaves it a little more open than just roads, but I think that's important. There is going to be a change in fuel efficiency. If you do nothing but just let the car fleet turn over, when people sell an old car and buy a new one, they get 5 miles to the gallon better efficiency with essentially the same car. So that's going to affect the overall demand in the local area, but I still feel like we ought to be looking at that. A lot of people say, oh, we don't want any taxes. And that would be ideal, but we also want lots of good infrastructure. And we won't go through a litany here, but we're behind on infrastructure improvements, not just in Provo, but around Utah County for sure. And we've seen recent articles talking about that. We've done a very good job, maybe too good a job, of protecting taxes and not building the infrastructure. We want to put in incubators and attract people to Provo. Let's make sure the infrastructure is there. We want to build out the west side. We got to make sure the infrastructure is there. And so I feel like this is a great thing. The proposal or the resolution that you have in front of you is okay in my mind. I'd like to see it sharpened a little bit to focus on transportation fuel taxes. Just, you know, an average car drives 1,000 miles a month, statistically. Raising fuel taxes by 10 cents a gallon will increase the average cost to a consumer $4 a month. Now, $4 is $4, but if that gives me better infrastructure, quicker transport times, and encouragement to buy fuel-efficient cars that will help the environmental issues we have, I think that's $4 a month well spent by the consumers in Provo. So that's my comment, is I feel strongly that we ought to look for and stay with a pay-as-you-go mechanism. There's some weird mechanisms proposed out there, but they're not really pay-as-you-go, and that makes it very administratively difficult to manage. But pay-as-you-go mechanism, and don't neglect the transportation tax as the biggest piece of this. And that's from an oil man. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Markham. We're glad that you were here as chairman of our city's Transportation and Mobility Committee. We value your input and opinion. Thank you for sharing that. And I think the beauty of a resolution that's broad like this and supportive of state legislation that would give the city tools is that we can decide how that would apply to our city and how the funds would be used. And we appreciate your thoughtful input. Thank you. Any other comments or questions or a motion?
Only there were a lot of there was a lot of discussion in our work session, and you may want to go back and look at the discussion in the work session as well. It was very helpful to speak with Cameron Deal, the Utah League of Cities and Towns, and Ken Bullock as well. They were able to shed some light on some of the options that the legislature will be looking at, and it's more of a list of ways, lots of different ways that we can address our transportation needs, and he said it was in flux, you know, and it will be in flux probably for a while on how that actually comes out, but we're just trying to support them in their efforts to recognize that we do see the need and would like the flexibility as a city to make decisions regarding our transportation needs as well. So thank you for your input.
I'd like to make another comment. Excuse me for, I wasn't able to get to the work session today, and I really regret that, but it was unavoidable. So I haven't heard all the argument. I've read a lot, and I'll listen to the work session. My point is, you know, you got to keep things in a parity. You know, worldwide fuel oil is in a parity with transportation and stuff. There's not much that one city can do if the neighboring city is not real close to that. Because it is a fact that for less than a nickel a gallon, people will drive 10 cents worth of gasoline to buy the fuel. And if you don't believe me, go up and watch who comes through the Costco lanes and where they're from. Now, if you're coming to Costco anyway, you think, well, that doesn't cost me anything. But it is interesting. And so one of the things that you look at is what all the neighboring states are. In the East Coast, it's a big issue that people jump state lines for a nickel a gallon. And so, again, having lots of flexibility as a city of Provo, to me, may not be very effective if the city of Orem doesn't choose to follow suit, or the city of Springville, if you understand what I say. We don't want to put our retail fuel sellers at a disadvantage by 2 or 3 cents a gallon, because people will, that will affect it. So I don't understand a case that is not in parity along the Wasatch Front, and would be really concerned about that.
And I didn't explain myself very well. I think the flexibility was more in relation to a sales tax, a local option sales tax, where we have the opportunity to do that or
it
not.
It still changes the price of gasoline at the pump, whether it's a sales tax option or a state excise tax or a federal excise tax. My biggest concern is if states don't act in the opportunity right now, and I mean states, not just Utah, to raise fuel taxes, the federal government will. And I can guarantee you they'll be less effective in spending it.
That was mentioned in the work session as well. Yeah. So,
and that's my concern is all-in price at the pump. You can't get out of parity amongst the towns or in the area, or you'll see a big shift in demand. And there's a lot of data that supports that from the API data that, you know, I've been privy to in the past. I know that's true. If you really want it, I can dig it up, but it'll bore you to tears. Thank you.
Thank you again, Mr.
Thank
Markham.
You.
Would anyone like to make a motion?
I'd like to make the motion that we allow this be a joint resolution between administration and city council to approve the resolution as written that we've received.
Thank you, Mr. Winterton. Is there a second? Mr. Sewell, thank you. So the motion is amended to become a joint resolution of the City Council and administration. Those in favor of this resolution?
So just point of order.
Mr. Mayor?
Would you like me to vote with you or?
Okay, I guess that's a point of question for if the administration can vote or not. Actually, raise their hand and be part of the vote. I should have.
They certainly can. The question is what it means, right? What it means is that the mayor is raising his hand to say, I, in a category of one, vote that the administration approves this recommendation. He's not voting as part of the council. So it's two separate votes that are happening at the same time. The mayor as a body of one is voting his opinion, and you as a body of seven are voting your opinion separately at the same time.
Okay, if that can be recorded that way too. It was recorded 8-0 last time, and I just wanted to make sure that was clarified, that it's the council is voting, and then he's voting for the administration then. And that's...
Right, it's up to the council. You know, there's two ways to accomplish the joint resolution. One is to take the vote of merely the council and then ask the mayor to sign. Certainly the council can, if they desire to do so, allow the mayor to also vote, but it should be clear in the minutes that his vote is a separate vote from the vote of the council body.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Jones.
Thanks for allowing me to clarify.
I'd be happy to have you vote, Mr. Mayor, as part of the resolution. So those in favor? Thank you. So the resolution passes, the council resolution passes 6-0 with Mr. Hales excused, and the administration resolution passes 1-0. No opposition. We'll turn to the final item of our agenda, which also is a resolution encouraging parents to speak with their youth about the dangers of fight nights in order to help ensure the health, safety, and welfare of our children. This resolution will be presented by Councilmember Santiago.
Thank you. If you remember, I think it was February, we had the discussion about the MMA fights, and we took another look at the fighting ordinance to decide whether or not to allow these types of fights at our convention center. And during those discussions, as we were looking into the ordinance, I reached out, I asked some questions about why the ordinance was put in the first place. I reached out to Mayor Billings, asked him about it, and found out that at the time that they put the ordinance in place, they were having what they called fight club fights around the city. There was a movie called Fight Club, and it had spurred on some of these spontaneous fights that they would call and gather in groups in various parts of the city and fight, and then someone would be left broken and bleeding on the pavement and everyone would run. And this was how it was described to me. And there are just the dangers of not having, you know, medical personnel. There were lots of issues with these fights that were cropping up. And so they put in an ordinance to so that the authorities or our police would have some mechanism for dealing with those that were engaging in these fights. So having that background, I started to ask some questions, and I found through youth and through the parents of youth that these fights hadn't gone away, or if they'd gone away, they had come back. They were alive and well. I don't know about well, but they were alive in our community still. And there had been about 10 of these. There had been 10 of these over a 9 to 10 month period that I was told about. And this, to me, was a disturbing trend in our community. And the more I learned about what they were, so fight nights, and they actually started out as lunchtime fights where kids would gather at somebody's home and they would don either MMA gloves or gloves of any type, and they would fight in 30-second intervals. And it just, two kids would call each other out and fight, and they would serve hot dogs or ice cream at the lunchtime fights. And some of the concerns for these types of get-togethers is that there were athletes, these are good kids, I think they considered it a sporting event, and there were parents present, and so they didn't think there was anything wrong. And these fights started happening at night, and they were coined fight nights. And parents would be there, police would come and try to find out what was happening, and then they would leave and no action was taken. So the youth were thinking that it, and the parents probably too, that there was nothing wrong with them, not knowing that they're actually illegal, or if they were made aware, they were not, wasn't enough to stop them. So, and so in an effort to get out information to let people know that it is illegal, it's illegal in our city, and it's also illegal in our state, that I came to find as I did more research on this. But the inherent dangers were that the youth would gather in some large groups, sometimes 100 kids in on a, you know, a backyard, and anyone in attendance could be called out. Girls would fight, boys would fight, it didn't matter. And the fact that they were in attendance, some didn't want to fight, but felt like they couldn't not fight. It was worse for them on social media later. The humiliation or the shaming was worse for them later than it would have been if they'd actually fought. This was something that the school administrator told me, that it's actually worse for these kids if they don't fight because of the shaming and the bullying that goes on. So, and they were very concerned about this as well. The other part of this is that the youth could be, you know, broken bones, there could be concussions, and there was no doctor on site to assess an injured youth, and no one to stop them from driving concussed. So they were thus putting the public at large at risk. And so I had drafted a letter and had the support of an attorney, two pediatricians, a school psychologist, presented it to the TempView PTA, and they supported it. The TempView principal, that I know, supported it. And we've also talked to the school district about it, and they are going to discuss it in their next meeting. But the last we heard, they had been able to talk to five different board members who were also supportive of it, just in the initial, you know, run through. But what I wanted to do was to, one, read the letter that I sent out, and then most of the information from the resolution came from this letter, and I would just like to read that for the public, general public. Friends and neighbors, we need your help. Our high school youth are participating in a disturbing trend that has largely been kept in the shadows. We need your help to get it out in the light of day so we can protect them from its harmful effects. Fight nights are currently being hosted at various homes with our high school kids attending in large numbers. They involve one youth calling out another to fight. They don gloves and fight for 30-second intervals, or occasionally until one is knocked senseless or unconscious. This process is often repeated, so there can be several fights in a given night, and any youth in attendance could get called out. In addition to the legal ramifications for youth associated with this activity, there are numerous inherent dangers. There is no protective headgear and no trained referee to stop a fight when a youth is rendered defenseless. There is no doctor present to assess the injured youth, and no one to stop a concussed youth from getting into a car and driving, putting him or herself and the public at large at risk. Injured youth are also unlikely to acknowledge their injuries to a parent because of the secretive nature of these gatherings, thus their injuries may go untreated. On their policy statement about boxing, the American Academy of Pediatrics has this to say, quote, "The American Academy of Pediatrics opposes the sport of boxing for children, adolescents, and young adults. Amateur boxing is a collision sport in which winning is based on the number and force of punches successfully landed on an opponent's head and or body. This deliberately exposes boxing participants to potentially devastating neurological and ocular injuries," close quote. The youth who attend these fights may think that they are just observers and will never participate. But what happens if they do get called out? Even if they don't want to fight, they may feel pressure to participate or endure shaming or ridicule from their peers. Some youth claim that everybody goes to these fights and that it doesn't seem wrong because the parents of the youth sponsoring the fights are present when the fights are occurring. Let's make no mistake about it. This creates opportunities for bullying and assault, and if parents are in attendance, they could be charged with contributing to the delinquency of minors. Please join us in getting the word out about the dangers of fight nights. We encourage you to talk to your youth about it. Ask them if they have attended and if they have fought. You may be surprised by their response. We can spend large amounts of money and resources on anti-bullying campaigns, but if parents endorse this type of fighting and authorities ignore it, what message are we really sending to our youth? Please take action and help ensure the health, safety, and welfare of our children. There has been made mention that these events happen so infrequently. I asked Representative Dean Sampay to look into it, and he got his research team on it, and they found that statewide there were 16 cases over the past seven years. They had 16 cases statewide from the sheriffs that they were able to get in contact with. Problem is that I think many go unreported. If I know about 10 of them in my small sphere, I'm guessing that it's a much bigger problem. And it was interesting because over the holidays I was on the internet with my son. We were looking up a popular clothing chain on the internet, and started looking at t-shirts. And there were six or seven t-shirts on boxing, but then there was a t-shirt that actually said Fight Club on it. And so I'm thinking if they're making t-shirts that say Fight Club on it, then it goes beyond our community borders. It's probably more something that is happening in a broader sense. So I am looking to have a little discussion on this, if you'd like to. We have discussed this with the Orem City Council. We've had several discussions about it in the past, and would love to hear your comments if you have any questions or thoughts that we haven't discussed so far. I'd just love to get your feedback.
Well, I just appreciate Councilmember Santiago's efforts on this and the educational outreach. I know that she knows people that have been injured, and so I'm all in favor of passing the resolution and helping to get the word out about the dangers of this activity.
Other comments? Input? Santiago?
Yeah, and I'd also like to thank Mr. Taylor for suggesting that we make this a resolution, because we can get the word out a little bit more effectively by doing so. So I appreciate his recommendation in doing this. And also, just to give you an update that I talked to Jimmer Fredette Foundation is planning on helping spread the word through their anti-bullying campaign as well, and they're working on that. So there are other opportunities for outreach, and I think it's so important to get this information out there so people are aware. I had lunch with a friend and was talking to this friend about it, and the friend said, "Oh, well, you know, I'll see if my son, you know, knows anything about this." Texted the son, "Have you heard about fight nights?" "Yes." "Have you participated?" "Yes." "Have you fought?" "Yes." And this person had no idea that their child was involved. And so we have concussion protocols for football players and for other sports, for any sport. I think in high school they take these concussion protocols. But if a youth gets concussed in a lunchtime fight or on a weekend fight, nobody knows, and then they play in a game that night. There's just a lot of risks involved with not having the awareness, and just hope that we can get the word out to as many as possible.
Thank you, Ms. Santiago.
Gary?
Yes, Mr.
I'm grateful to know. I think one of the things that I'm grateful for in this is that it actually shows that it is against the law. and that wasn't in our original resolution. And I'm grateful to have it in there now to show that it is. What is the penalty for the Class B misdemeanor? I'm just curious as to what that would be.
A Class B misdemeanor can be punishable by up to a year in jail or a $1,000 fine or both. Now, that's not usually the penalty for a Class B misdemeanor, but that's the maximum penalty.
Thank you, Mr. Jones.
And there is state law that makes it a Class A misdemeanor, which also carries, at least Mr. Sanpei said, it carries a year, possibly a year in jail as well.
Yeah, or Class A can be, I think, 18 months. They both kind of cover different things. The city ordinance covers promoting or organizing the event if there's, you know, 10 or more people in attendance. The state law prohibits, I can't remember now what the term they use is, but it's a defined term, and it covers kind of a narrow set of circumstances. It may not necessarily apply to every one of these situations, but is something else that we could use as an alternative.
So we have in front of us a resolution that contains most of the information that Councilmember Santiago referred to in her letter. And then, of course, the ultimate outcome is what's listed on the screen as the resolution encouraging parents to speak with their youth about the dangers of fight nights. And this is similar to our previous resolution. This is a joint resolution of the Provo City Mayor and Municipal Council. So I'll look for a motion at this time.
Move to approve the resolution as written.
Thank you, Ms. Santiago. And a second. Mr. Sewell, thank you. Those in favor? Those opposed? So the council vote is 5-1 in favor. Mr. Van Buren, Mr. Sewell, Ms. Santiago, Mr. Garrett, Mr. Winterton, and those opposed, Mr. Miller, with Mr. Hales excused. And the administration vote is 1-0, unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you. That brings us to the end of our agenda, so I'll look for a motion to dismiss. Ms. Santiago, thank you, and a second. Mr. Van Buren, thank you. Those in favor? Those in favor of dismissing? Unanimous, thank you.